Thanks, thanks. I was actually struggling with the panel. Thank you, Megha, for the introduction, elaborated introduction. I hope everybody can hear me fine. Let me
Yes, we
see if I
can.
get. Okay, great. Yes. Okay, let us hearing from Varun and Dr. Purushottam, let us take a global perspective as to why, nowadays we are talking about the urgency. And we are basically on the brink of missing the opportunity to limit the global warming to 1.5 degrees centigrade. And if we rely on the current, climate commitments or pledges that are being made by the countries under Paris Agreement, temperatures can be expected to rise to 3.2 degrees centigrade this century. And the temperatures are already increased by 1.1 degree centigrade. And we can see the devastations that it has, across the globe related to the impacts of the climate change. Now, UNEP emission gap report of 2019 suggests that we are failing. And these three numbers that you see on the slide are basically holding the fate of the world. Now, scientists agree that to get on track to limit the global temperature to 1.5 degrees centigrade, emission must drop rapidly to 25 gigatons of CO2e by 2030. Our challenge is, based on the current commitments, emissions are on track to reach 56 gigatons of CO2e by 2030, which is twice over what they should be. And collectively, if the commitments and the policies and the actions can drive a 7.6% emission reduction every year, then between 2020 and 2030, we can limit global warming to 1.5 degrees centigrade. Now, given this context, climate actions by non-state actors such as businesses, including MSMEs, is becoming increasingly important. And for that, one has to understand its own GHG emission footprint, right? So GHG protocol establishes comprehensive global standardized framework to measure and manage GHG emissions. For private and public sector operations, value chains, etc. And the corporate accounting and reporting standards provides the platform for virtually every corporate GHG reporting program in the world. In fact, in 2016, in 92% of Fortune 500 companies responding to CDP used GHG protocol directly or indirectly through a program which is based on the corporate accounting and the reporting standards. So let's talk about certain principles that we need to keep in mind while we move ahead with the reporting, accounting, and the reporting standard. But before that, maybe we can do an exercise. Okay, so we have this quick poll. GHG accounting and reporting should be based on which of the following principles?
You'll have 30 seconds to answer this question. You can also choose multiple options in the answers provided.
Okay, so the poll results shows that 80% of the audience believe that the transparency is one of the very key important principles, followed by accuracy, and then consistency, relevance, and completeness. Yeah, maybe we can switch back to the slides. Well, you know, we need basically all these five principles. You know, these five principles are very important when we go about, you know, greenhouse gas accounting. So what actually we mean by all these five terms, we'll start with the transparency. So activity data, emission sources, emission factors, accounting methodology, all these things require adequate documentation and disclosure to enable verification, which means that this information should be sufficient to allow individuals who are outside the inventory process to use these same information, and they should be able to derive the same results. Any kind of exclusions shall be clearly identified, disclosed, and justified. The reported GHG emissions shall appropriately reflect emissions occurring as a result of activity and the emission patterns, and that's why the relevance comes into the picture. The calculations of the GHG emissions shall not systematically understate or overstate actual GHG emissions. So that's where the accuracy part comes in. So accuracy should be sufficient enough to give decision makers and the public reasonable assurance of the integrity of the reported information. And very important factor is that uncertainty in quantification of the GHG emissions shall be reduced to the extent that is possible and pragmatic. Next is completeness. Now the inventory compiler or the user shall account for all required emission sources within the chosen inventory boundary. Any kind of exclusion of the emission sources shall be justified and clearly explained. The last part is consistency. So emission calculations shall be consistent in approach, in boundary, and in methodology. And using this consistent methodologies for calculating GHG emission basically enables companies to arrive at a meaningful documentation of the emission changes over time. The companies can do trend analysis. They can compare what their emission scenarios look like currently as compared to a previous year. And any kind of deviation from the preferred methodology shall be disclosed and justified. Having said this, there are certain trade-offs when it comes to using these principles when we go about GHG accounting. And it is important to emphasize that completeness should be achieved over accuracy. That is, it is preferable to have a complete report of key economic sectors, key source categories and subcategories, even if accuracy is low, then only the part of the sector reported very accurately. And this should help guide and prioritize effort, and it should also help in identifying the highest emitting sources. If I can give one example, which basically is not related to the corporate sector or the MSME per se, but Kampala, which is a city in Uganda, traded the data accuracy for a broader data set covering all the sectors. And they have used the data from the different sources and years, and they have scaled it up or they have combined it in order to complete their inventory. So you can see this is one of the examples wherein they have traded accuracy. Now we have covered the main principle part. Let us talk about how we need to go about when it comes to setting the boundaries. So there are two things that we need to bear in mind. There are two types of boundaries basically. One is organizational and second one is the operational boundary. We'll get into the details of this in coming slides, but now why should a company or an MSME should bother about the organizational boundaries? Why is it important? You see, business operations vary in their legal and organizational structures. They include wholly owned operations. They might also include incorporated and non-incorporated joint ventures. There could be subsidiaries, franchises, et cetera, different kind of, you know, business structures. So for the purpose of the financial accounting, they are treated according to the established rules that depends on the structure of the organization and the relationship among the parties that are involved. So in setting the organizational boundary for the GHG accounting, a company should select an approach for consolidating the GHG emissions and then consistently apply that selected approach to define those businesses or the operations that constitute the company for the purpose of accounting and reporting GHG emissions. So organizational boundary basically, you know, determines which company needs to be included in the GHG inventory, what percentage of each operations to include. And I can understand that you might not be having a grasp of what percentage means, but hopefully we will get into that soon in the coming slides. Okay, so when we talk about the consolidation approaches, you know, there are basically for corporate reporting, there are two distinct approaches that can be used. One is equity share approach and one is control approach. And we will discuss this in greater details, but it is important to note that once the company chooses the approach, that approach need to be consistently applied across entire organization. If the reporting company wholly owns all its operations, its organization is same, whichever approach is used. And we will understand in the coming slide as to why it happens. But for companies with the joint operations, the organizational boundary and the resulting emissions may differ, you know, depending upon the approach that the company has chosen. Let's talk about the equity share approach. So under this approach, a company accounts for the GHG emissions from the operations according to its share of equity in the operations. And you might see a little bit of alignment with, you know, how we do the financial accounting and stuff. And this has been sort of, you know, if I can say, inspired by that kind of framework. It is obviously independent of financial or operational control. Typically, the share of economic risk and the rewards in an operation is aligned with the company's percentage ownership of that particular operation, and equity share will normally be the same as the ownership percentage. But there are cases, you know, where it is not the case, which means that the percentage ownership is not equivalent to the equity share. And in those cases, the economic substance of the relationship the company has with the operation always overrides the legal ownership form to ensure that equity share reflects the percentage of economic interest. So let us try and understand it with an example. Okay, let us consider that there is a company who has a 50% equity share in a factory A, and the emission is 1,000 metric tons of CO2 per year for a particular year. So if the company chooses the equity approach, you know, then the emission will be as per the equity. It means that it will account for only 500 metric tons of CO2 per year. Similarly, if the company has 85% equity in another factory which has 1,000 metric tons of CO2 emission per year, then it will account for 850 tons of CO2. It means that it will basically depend on the equity share that I just spoke about. Control approach. So under this approach, a company accounts for 100% of the emissions, 100% of the GHG emissions from operations over which it has control. It does not account for GHG emissions from the operations in which it owns an interest, but has no control. Right, and we'll understand what this control word means. But the control further divided into two parts. One is financial control and another one is operational control. Financial control. So the company has financial control over the operation. If the company has the ability to direct the financial and operational policies. I'm repeating again, direct the financial and the operational policies with a view to gain economic benefits from its activities. Again, obviously, it accounts for 100% of the emissions from the operations under the financial control. But typically, the share under this approach, basically, the economic substance of the relationship between the company and the operation take precedence over the legal ownership status. Let us understand this with an example. So say, for example, there's a company which has a financial control over factory A, and the emission is 800 metric ton of CO2 per year. Now, as per if the reporting company chooses the financial control approach, then according to that, it will account for 800 metric tons of CO2 while reporting its GHG emissions. But if it does not have a financial control over another factory B, then it will not account for any emissions from factory B while reporting for the GHG emissions. Operational control. So a company has an operational control over operations if the company has the full authority to introduce and implement its operational policies at the operation. And again, you know, if we can understand it by an example, if the company has an operational control, then it will obviously account for the entire emissions. But if the reporting company does not have, then it will not account for any kind of emissions while reporting its GHG emissions. Okay. There are a few points that we need to bear in mind going forward. When we talk about having an operational control, it does not necessarily mean that the company has authority to make all decisions concerning an operation. For example, you know, the big capital investment firms, they might have joint financial control, so they would require approvals from all the partners if they want to make any sort of changes. Similarly, sometime a company, you know, have a joint financial control over an operation, but not operational control. In such cases, the inventory compiler will have to dig a little deep, and they have to understand the contractual agreement to understand, you know, the authority over the operations. This slide again basically shows certain categories and certain definitions and what kind of an approach they take and what will happen. So for group companies and subsidiaries, this basically includes incorporated and non-incorporated joint ventures and partnerships over which the parent company has the financial control. And here the parent company is reporting GHG emissions. So we see it from the parent company point of view. And the group companies and subsidiaries are fully consolidated, which means that 100% of subsidiaries, income, expenses, assets, liabilities, etc., are taken into parent company's profit and loss account or balance sheet. You know, so in that case, if the company, the reporting company or the parent company chooses to go by the equity share approach, then they report as per their equity share with the group companies or the subsidiaries. But if they chooses to go for the financial control, then they will have to account for 100% of the GHG emissions. Similarly, for the associated or affiliated companies, that again includes, you know, incorporated and non-incorporated joint ventures and partnerships. Here, the parent company has a significant influence over the operations and the financial policies of the company, but does not have the financial control. So where it does not have a financial control, and if the reporting company goes by the financial control, the emissions is zero. But if it goes by the equity share, then it depends on what is their equity share with that you know, affiliated or associated company. And they will report their GHG emissions as per the percentage. Franchises are the separate legal entities. In most cases, franchisor will not have equity right or control over franchisee. However, if the equity right or the control exist, the same rule applies that applies for the group companies or the subsidiaries. In case of fixed, you know, fixed asset investments, the parent company has neither significant influence nor financial control, and this category also includes JVs and the partnerships over which parent company does not have, you know, significant influence. And the financial accounting basically applies cost dividend method to fixed asset investment. Therefore, it doesn't matter which approach you choose, you do not report your GHG emissions under for the fixed asset investment. All right, so time exercise two. I hope I'm not too fast.
You are not too fast, but the time is kind of you're taking a little longer. So there aren't too many questions. So maybe you can use 5 more minutes for your topic.
I'll try to cover as much as possible.
Okay, so 5 more minutes for that then.
Okay, so are we skipping the exercise or we are doing it?
I think we can skip the exercise. What do you think, Tejaswini?
I think we can do one question right now and then we'll skip the other two that were planned.
Okay, then let's go ahead. All right, so this is an hypothetical situation where company ABC has full control of operations. A, B, and 30% non-operated equity control over a company C. Now, ABC's boundary, when we talk about from the operational control point of view, is, I guess you will have 30 seconds to sort of think and answer. Thank you. Okay, I guess 67% have voted for the option B, and 25% says that it should be option A, and 9% says all emission of A, B, and C. Now, company A, B, C has full control of operations. Full control of operations. So A, B, and C, if we are going from the operational control point of view, I think it will go for operational control for A and B, the emissions of A and B. But if you want to sort of include C, if we consider both the approaches, what should be, then probably it should be option B. Anyways, well, let's go ahead with the presentation. I have 5 more minutes. So we have spoken about the organizational boundaries. Let us quickly speak up, you know, go ahead with the operational boundaries. You know, after setting the organizational boundary in terms of operations that is owned or controlled, it is the company basically goes for setting the operational boundary, which involves identifying emissions associated with its operations and categorizing them as direct and indirect emissions and choosing the scope of accounting and reporting of indirect emissions. So the slide, the picture that you can see on the slide basically provides you with a brief snapshot hypothetical situation of operational and the organizational boundary. Let us talk about the direct and indirect emissions. And it's pretty plain and simple. So direct emissions basically refers to the GHG emissions from the sources that is owned and controlled by the reporting company. And indirect emissions are basically those emissions that are consequence of the activities of the reporting company, but occurs at the source owned and controlled by another company. So for example, you are having your factory, and then you are drawing an you know, electricity from the power plant, or you have this you know, maintenance service from another company. So the direct emission basically is related to your factory, and the indirect emissions is basically any emissions other than the direct emissions. So scope one emissions, some examples like electricity generation or physical or chemical processing, etc. And when it comes to, you know, reporting requirement, the scope one emissions are required to be reported. So basically, this is your scope one emissions, the direct emissions that is coming out of your factory. This is just an hypothetical example, by the way. Scope two basically refers to purchased electricity, steam, heating, and cooling. Again, in Indian context, probably we do not really talk about the purchased steam or heating and cooling, but yes, purchased electricity. So for office-based businesses, you know, scope two emissions is usually most significant. And the inclusion in the GHG inventory while reporting for the GHG emissions is required. So your scope two emission is basically the electricity that you purchase from the grid. Scope three emissions are basically those emissions which are not scope one and scope two. And example that I have already given earlier as well, you know, transport in vehicles that are not owned or controlled by the reporting company. And when it comes to reporting, it's optional. So the indirect emissions that is coming out of the vehicle is basically the scope three emissions. To give you the full spectrum of the entire emission gamut that I just spoke about and categorizing it based on the scope one, scope two, and scope three emissions, you can see in the picture. Scope one basically refers to the emissions happening in your chosen boundary. Scope two is obviously, you know, purchased electricity, and scope three refers to the upstream and the downstream activities. And there is a detailed guidance on how you can go about accounting for the scope three emissions, but we're not going into details for that particular standard today. Let me just keep.
Sorry, Subrata, to interrupt you. I think some of the participants wanted the exercises to happen. So we will keep shorter time for the exercises. So we can go back to the previous.
You can launch the poll.
Yeah. So you'll have 30 seconds to answer this question.
Okay, I guess we can go back. Yeah, majority of the folks have got it right, so maybe we can go ahead. We report on all the seven greenhouse gases. Okay, so while determining the scope, you know, it is important to understand this, that we do not really determine the scope on the basis of the type of emission sources, but it is being determined by the ownership or the control of the emission sources. So what I mean by this is basically, if this is an, you know, it basically depends on the reporting company. If the reporting company is a electricity generating company, then for it, all the fuel consumption will be reported under the scope one by that particular reporting company. But if the reporting company is a different company and it is, its main business is not energy generation, it is just drawing electricity from this particular plant, then it will account the emissions under scope two. Okay, exercise four. 30 seconds perhaps. It's a relatively easy poll question. Okay, can we see the results? All right. Okay. So 78% believe it's a scope 2 emissions. Absolutely correct. All right. So, you know, let's quickly talk about how do you track emissions over time once you have, you know, figured out your organizational and the operational boundary. Quickly, base year is basically a term that is used in GHG accounting, and it's basically a reference point in the past with which your current emissions can be compared. And what I mean is basically, as you can see in the slide, you know, if I have these emission figures for a certain period of time for a particular company, I can totally understand that if my base year is 2016, so in 2019, probably there's an increase of 21% of emissions over the base year. Choosing a base year is very, you know, important factor. We need to select the earliest year for which verifiable emission data for the required scopes is available. So by required scopes, I mean scope 1 and scope 2. We need to also specify why we are choosing that particular year as a base year. There might be a certain situation where, you know, the emissions dramatically fluctuates, and it basically happens for the companies who have, you know, a lot of acquisitions and mergers going on. In that case, you know, you can take a series of consecutive years as your base year. The average, basically, the corporate accounting and reporting standard does not provide any kind of thumb rule for it, but 2 to 3 years of time should be enough. Okay. Due to some reasons, okay. All right. Recalculating base year is an important thing, and companies often undergo significant structural changes, acquisitions, divestment, mergers that I just mentioned, and these changes will alter companies' historic emission profile, making meaningful you know, comparisons over time difficult. So we need to recalculate the base year once that kind of thing happens. The company, the reporting company, should also develop a recalculation policy, and it should be applied in a consistent manner and should be articulated very clearly and transparently while reporting for the GHG emissions. We recalculate base year GHG emissions for significant changes in the structure of the organizations, significant changes in the calculation methodology, and, you know, during the calculation, if we discover that there are certain significant errors or the small errors that happened over the period of time and collectively are significant. Significant threshold is basically, it's basically a, you know, qualitative or quantitative criteria that is used to determine whether, you know, whether a change is significant enough to warrant the recalculations. And we need to take into consideration the cumulative effect of the small acquisitions or divestments. There is again no thumb rule given by the corporate accounting and reporting standard, but normally people go for 5% on 10% threshold. Structural changes basically refers to the transfer of ownership or control of emitting activities from one company and the other, which I have already discussed. I'm not going to get into too much of a detail of this. Time for one exercise.
Is this the closing? Because we'll close after this exercise for this session.
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay.
I'm actually done with the slides, I guess.
Can you show the answer?
Okay, great. I guess majority of the folks have got the answer right. It's all of the above. So yeah, with that, I can pass it on to Megha. Megha, you can take over, and thank you for the opportunity. I'll be happy to answer any questions if you have.
Thank you, Subrata, for a detailed overview on the standards and basic accounting required. concepts. I would skip the Q&A right now that we have, and you can still type in your questions and we'll try to address them through either sending it as chat boxes to you or to the speakers. Thank you, Tejaswini, Dr. Sunita, for the previous session. We will now take the rest